The process mapping analysis details and supplements the SIPOC. We have defined the limits of the SIPOC in such a way that its core process steps, from the chronologically last problem upstream to the first relevant input, enclose all triggering influences of all defined problems. In the process mapping part, we will first detail the process steps into underlying discrete activities. In the process analysis part, we will then identify the triggers of the problems in the methods and resources, as we already did it with the inputs in the input analysis. If you do not perform all process steps of the SIPOC yourself, between first input and last output, you should conduct a workshop with the employees who perform the activities of the process steps and know the negative influences from their daily work. If you first map and analyze the process on flipcharts, then all participants can easily follow and contribute. Only after the workshop, you should transfer the most important information of the flipcharts into SigmaGuide. I have seen many process mappings of varying complexity. In a rather complex purchasing process, from ordering to delivery, we wallpapered all walls of the team room with flipcharts of the process mapping. In another quite easy process, we only needed half of a flipchart for a tool change on a machine. In the workshop, I first note the name of the process in the first line of the first flipchart. Then I write the names of all departments involved in the process steps on stickers. Next, we order these departments in the first column in the chronology of their appearance in the process. This is the prerequisite for arranging the activities on the flipchart in the typical cascade from the upper left to the lower right side. Now we know the answer to the first key question: who is involved in the process? Next, we will find out what is done. To prepare the place for the activities, I draw horizontal boundary lines in the flipchart for each department. This type of process mapping is called swim lane diagram, in contrast to the flowchart, which is often used for official process documentation. But we don't want to document the process. We won't even consider decisions that are usually marked as diamonds in a flowchart. In our bakery, the customer is on top of the department list and I ask, what is the customer typically doing first? We already know the answer from the SIPOC: transmit request for cookies. I note this activity on a sticker and post it to the right of the first department. Make sure that you always describe activities at least with a verb and a noun, because only verbs can express activities and the noun represents the object of the certain activity. To really understand the process, it is important to describe the activities as consciously and precisely as possible. This is not always easy for me, and I sometimes need several attempts to really describe what happens. But it is a good exercise for the learning to see. Thus, please try it. To continue the process mapping, I ask a variant of the second question: what happens next? And I also write the answer, determine cookie type and delivery date, on a sticker. This is the first activity of the department, logistic and procurement. And I put the sticker of this second activity in the corresponding swim lane, right of the first activity and below the first swim lane. This sequential order of activities from left to right illustrates the chronology of the process, and it ensures that we later can examine activity by activity individually for its negative influences. What happens next? The department production support determines necessary and missing ingredients. The following activity, purchase missing ingredients, will again be carried out by logistic and procurement. We do not need a second swim lane for the second activity of this department, but stick the node in its existing swim lane. The repeated involvement of the same departments, visible by the interruption of the sticker cascade, reveals potential in the interfaces and in the sequence of activities later in the improve phase. Next, our chef de cookie preheats the oven and continues the chronology of activities in the cascade of nodes. I continue to collect the activities up to deliver cookies, which directly leads to the less problematic output, cookie delivered. Now I prepare the process analysis part for the collection of further information for the analysis of the activities. In the next swim lane, the inputs of the activities can be specified. This is not strictly necessary for the analysis, but can support the orientation in the diagram. Thus, my third question is, which input is necessary for the activity? Strictly necessary for the analysis are, however, the methods and resources used for the specific implementation of the activity. Any negative influence on and from a specific activity subtracts something from an assumed best practice activity to generate a best practice output in the targeted quality, availability, and consumption. It is again not necessary to enter the outputs of the activities in the next swim lane, although this, as with the input, can again facilitate the orientation in the diagram. My fourth question is accordingly, which output results from the activity? In the next three lines, the negative influences of the methods and resources on or from the activity must be specified. And in the last line, the percentual frequency must be estimated how often the negative influence affects the activity. Let's start the analysis. The first activity, transmit request for cookies, is executed by the customer, and we do not know and do not care about the influences in activities of customers. After receiving the input, request for cookies, already evaluated in the input analysis, our bakery determines the cookie type and delivery date. Now I ask the participants two questions about the methods and resources. Which resources execute or support the execution of the activity? And which methods guide the execution? The method of the focused activity in our video is a simple calendar entry. The resources are Laura in her role as logistic and procurement service, a calendar and a pencil. I only enter these trivially given resources if they are a source of a negative influence. The next question is about negative influences, and I ask my participants, which influences from the methods and resources on or by the activities negatively affected the quality and the availability of the output or the consumption and waste of input and resources in the past? And I get and note the answer that very seldom the wrong cookie type was determined and that sometimes in the past laborious clarifications with the customer were necessary. Now I check whether these influences are direct triggers of problems and not root causes from the end of the causal chain. I accept wrong cookie type determined, but I would not have accepted customer's handwriting illegible, which could be a cause of the wrong determination. Please only accept the last trigger in a chain of causes that directly influences the activity negatively. It must be always obvious for you that and how the negative influence can affect the activity and leads to a problem. Now I assign the influences to the problem categories. The influence wrong cookie type determined can clearly affect our first problem, because the customer expects a different type of cookie. Therefore, it is an influence on the quality of the output. It is noticeable that the second influence negatively affects the time consumption of resources, but does not affect any of our defined problems. However, in the workshop, the experts stressed the high amount of effort involved in clarifying the orders in the past. Now the question arises whether the additional problem, cookies boxed, working time consumption too high, should be included in the voice to criticals tool, to be able to continue its analysis. It is quite possible that you also find negative influences in your activities that have no relation to one of your defined problems, and it would be perfectly normal to adjust the project charter retroactively, together with the sponsor, to add or change entries. I don't do that here, but ask the last question for this activity. How often did the most relevant and most important of these influences affect the output in the past? And my participants estimate the frequency of clarifying a request at 10% of the cases. We switch to the third activity, determine necessary and missing ingredients, which transforms the order for cookie type and delivery date into the shopping list. My question about the methods that control this activity leads first to amazement and then to the statement that it is very simple and that every employee follows his or her personal habits. As the method I therefore write, personal habit. And of course, you know that personal habits can lead to variability in the activity and thus to variability in the output. My question about the concrete negative influences is answered by the participants by the fact that in the past sometimes the wrong ingredients were determined. And they estimate its frequency at 5%. This is not so often, but the negative influence of wrong ingredients on the taste of cookies, and thus on our first problem, is obvious. In the C&E matrix, we will later evaluate the strength of this relationship. In the fourth activity, purchase missing ingredients, the negative influence, necessary ingredients not available, occurred in about 5% of the cases. And there is probably a relationship to the second problem, cookies delivered too early or too late. In the fifth activity, the oven is preheated too early and/or too hot in 5% of the cases. This affects the energy consumption and thus our third problem. So I continue for all remaining activities and collect the negative influences and the frequencies up to the delivery of the cookies and their evaluation by the customer. Finally, I reviewed the prepared process mapping analysis with the experts, corrected mistakes and rearranged or added missing information, which is very easy with the stickers. Now think about your own workshop. And what do you think of these suggestions? First, keep calm. A certain amount of inner tension is good because it indicates that your necessary mental energy is mobilized. However, too much nervousness can also be an obstacle. If I get too excited, I try to speak slower, breathe more evenly and deeply. And this helps me to calm down. Invite participants and inform the sponsor. Ask for a guided tour of the process, get the workshop materials, prepare the room. Take care of your participants. The better they feel, the better your results. Take the tour of the process, real on the shop floor or virtually through the screens of a software. No matter if you know the process or not. Let the experts show you inputs, outputs, methods, resources, activities, and negative influences. And if allowed, take photos and screenshots as a reference for the workshop. In the workshop, repeat the following micro-process until you have received a valid answer to the 8 questions for each activity. Ask one of these standard questions and do not vary them, because you might get a different, invalid answer. Check the answer. Summarize relevant aspects and let the participants check your understanding of the answer. You do not need to know everything about the process, but you need to understand the workflow, know its influences, and know how they are impacting. Concentrate on the questions and so lead the workshop again with the key questions if you get off the subject. Note the relevant information on a sticker. For the process mapping, note the activities in the format verb plus noun. Find the verb and noun that most accurately describe the activity. This ensures that you describe the actual as-is process. Do not rely on given process descriptions and record wishes mentioned for the should-be process on an additional flipchart. In detailing the core process steps into individual activities, you need to find the balance between two specific and two general descriptions. For input-output methods and resources, simply write their names on different stickers each for the flipchart. If there is a method missing, then write personal habits. Negative influences. Identify a direct influence, i.e. the last trigger in the causal chain, that causes or contributes to the defined problems. Check the relationship between influence and problem. This relationship must be rationally comprehensible, such as the influence of too early preheating of the oven on our problem of too high energy consumption. In between, thank your experts for their answers. Nobody likes to talk about mistakes, but we are overall talking about mistakes in our project. It is important that it is never about guilt, that you do not look for anyone to blame and prevent the allocation of guilt, because we want to solve problems and create a good climate in our personal relationships. Finally, take a picture of yourself and the team in front of your flipchart as a reminder for you and as a workshop confirmation for us. After the workshop, you can copy the results of the flipcharts to SigmaGuide. First, select the executing departments from the upper left list boxes with the suppliers and customers of the SIPOC. Then transfer the activities, inputs, outputs, methods, resources, and negative influences with their probability. The number of activities on your flipchart is probably higher than the number of core process steps of your SIPOC. SigmaGuide can, however, only take up a maximum of 20 activities in total. When you transfer activities from the flipchart, it may be necessary for you to combine, for example, 2 activities in one column. Important here is, however, that all relevant negative influences are entered and assigned to the activities. If you transferred all information from the flipchart to the tool, you can go to the related chart. In the chart Influence of Process, you get an overview of the activities with their negative influences and their probability. As you can see, the 8th activity, where our chef tests the chocolate, has the highest probability to occur. With this first workshop, you will have completed a significant part of your project again, and you can enter the results in your project storybook.